Well, it's been several months since Samsung's Nuclear Note 7 fiasco, but we now finally have the exact cause for why the Note 7 batteries were catching fire, thanks to a massive investigation by Samsung themselves. So I thought I would make this video to explain exactly what happened in a way that is easy to understand for basically anyone. And it is pretty interesting because, as you might know, they recalled the phone and made new ones with totally different batteries from a different manufacturer, and they still were catching fire. It turns out that both sets of batteries had their own separate issues. So that's what I wanted to explain in this video. Let's find out what went wrong. So the first thing I want to do is quickly go over the basics of how batteries in phones are structured, and I'll try to make it pretty interesting, not too boring. Now, really every battery, no matter what kind, requires at least two components: an anode, which holds the negative charge, and the cathode, which holds the positive charge. And then there are electrons and ions in there, which are charged at different parts of the battery, which actually hold the energy. Now, I'm not going to explain the chemistry or anything behind this, but the important thing to know is that the electrons and the charged ions want to get from one side to the other, and this gives them a lot of potential energy. When they are allowed to move, they release this energy, which can power the device. And there's also going to be some sort of separator between the anode and the cathode, which is semi-permeable, and it's going to prevent the charge from just transferring instantly, which would be a short circuit. So this allows you to control how much energy is being used by the phone when it needs it. Then, when you go to charge the phone, for example, you're basically using external energy from your wall to get the charge back on the original side so they have potential energy again. Now, batteries obviously come in all sorts of shapes and sizes depending on how you arrange the anode and the cathode. They come in a bunch of different shapes. Looking specifically at lithium ion batteries for the Note 7, they used what is known as a jelly roll design. It's kind of a funny name. This is where the anode and the cathode and the separator are layered in basically one long strip, and then it's rolled up. And depending on the shape of the battery, like the cylindrical batteries you might typically see, it kind of looks like a jelly roll, and that's where it gets its name. In this case though, the battery is kind of like a flattened jelly roll. So even though the battery is flat, the layers inside are still rolled around each other, which is important to understand for the thing next. To get a better idea of how this looks, this is a side view diagram looking at the flat side of the battery, and here is a top view. So in the side view, you can see that there are cross sections of the layers, and that's how they're arranged. So now that we know how the batteries are designed and structured, we're ready to understand exactly what happened, what went wrong. So in the first battery, the battery housing was misshapen and the corners were basically too rounded off. And this basically crushed the tops of the layers against each other, which in some cases could cause the anode and cathode to touch each other directly, which would result in a short circuit. The second battery, however, the one they put in after the first recall, had a totally different problem though. The cathode sheet in that one, which is typically metal, apparently had large burrs from the manufacturing process. A burr is basically a protrusion or a deformity from welding or cutting metal. In this case, it was called welding burrs, so I guess it was from welding. But anyway, these burrs stuck out enough on the sheet, so it actually penetrated the separating layer between the anode and cathode, causing direct contact between them. Again, causing a short circuit. Also, in the second battery, they apparently forgot to include insulation tape in many of them, making it even more likely for this to happen. So in both batteries, there was different problems which had the same result, a short circuit. But what exactly happens when there is a short circuit, and how does that make the battery catch on fire? Well, think of what happens when you're using your phone to run a game or some other intensive app that uses a lot of CPU power. Your phone probably heats up, and part of that, of course, is from the processor, but the battery also heats up, and this is because when it's releasing energy, it's not 100% efficient, so some of it is released as heat. Some of that energy is not electrical, but rather heat. But that's under controlled circumstances, when the battery is being governed and how much energy it can release at once. Obviously, it's only going to release what it needs. But imagine now that the anode and cathode in the battery short circuit, and all the energy is released at once. Now you've got a totally uncontrolled chemical reaction, and if it gets hot enough, it achieves thermal runaway. which is exactly what it sounds like. The heat from the release of the energy heats up the battery, which then causes it to release more energy, and it continues, and then it will likely burst into flames and burn quite spectacularly unless all the energy is released. And how much energy is that exactly? A lot. Now buckle up and get ready to have your mind blown. So we know that the Galaxy Note 7 battery is about 3,500 milliamp hours, which is 3.5 amp hours. An amp is a unit, which means 1 coulomb per second of current. And a coulomb is just an electrical unit of charge. If we multiply 3.5 amp hours times the number of seconds in an hour, we now know that the Galaxy Note 7 battery holds about 12,600 coulombs of charge. But what does that even mean? You guys have no reference for that, so this is really the fun part. How many coulombs do you think are in an average bolt of lightning? I'll give you a second to think about it. If a battery has 12,000, then maybe a bolt of lightning, a million, a billion? Well, actually, it's 15. 15 coulombs in a bolt of lightning. That's right, one cell phone battery has more electrical charge than 800 bolts of lightning. So it should no longer be a surprise when you see a lithium battery literally shooting jets of fire out of itself when it fails. Now, obviously there is a big difference between the damage caused from a battery fire and 800 bolts of lightning. The amount of charge isn't the whole story, as you can imagine, just like how tasers can be a million volts and still not kill you. That's not all you have to look at. The difference is in how the energy is released. In a lightning bolt, all of its charge is released in around 30 microseconds, which is 30 millionths of a second, whereas a lithium battery under thermal runaway might take a couple minutes. So even though the battery has hundreds of times more charge, the battery also takes literally millions of times longer to release its energy. It's pretty fun stuff. But anyway, let's get back on topic. So what is Samsung doing about this to prevent any issues in the future? It actually turns out they're doing a lot. They implemented an 8-point battery safety check process, which even includes using an X-ray to look for issues. They formed a battery advisory group of external advisors and researchers, and they implemented new safety measures in the batteries themselves. For example, higher standards for battery materials, protective brackets around the batteries, and software to control battery behavior. It seems pretty clear to me that at least they're taking this whole thing seriously, not like they really have a choice, but it's still nice to see. And even though it was only a tiny fraction of devices that actually did catch fire, I think it was like maybe 100 out of millions, it still brought a ton of attention to battery safety in general. Lithium batteries are pretty safe, and there's different kinds that are even safer than lithium ion. But when they fail big league. I think this will cause other companies to think twice about cheaping out on battery materials and hopefully implement a lot of the same safety features as Samsung. I highly doubt that other phone manufacturers are gonna wanna endure the embarrassment and brand damage of having a complete product recall and literally people making jokes about their phones exploding. So overall, I think it definitely sucks that this happened in the first place, but in the end, we'll probably benefit from it more as a tough lesson. So I hope you guys enjoyed this video, and if you did, definitely let me know what you think down in the comments section. Are you happy that Samsung is doing this? Do you trust them more? Do you trust them less because of the whole explosion thing? Were you amazed about how much batteries hold and charge? Let me know. And if you like this video, if you could give it a thumbs up, I'd really appreciate it. It really helps. And if you want to keep watching, I'll put some other videos right here. You can click on these even if you're on a phone, as long as it's not on fire. And if you want to subscribe, I make new videos every Tuesday, Thursday, Saturday, so it should be worth it. And also consider clicking the bell next to the subscribe button so YouTube will actually show you the new videos. So thanks again, guys, for watching. I'm looking forward to hearing from you. And of course, as usual, I'll see you next time. Have a good one.